Hey everyone, my name is Paul. I'm one of the teaching pastors here at Epic. We are so glad to be here with you today. Hey, we're gonna do something that we call here at Epic 60 seconds of forced friendship. So here's how this works. I want everybody at all of our locations, this is everybody, I want you to find two or three people sitting near you. I'm gonna ask you a question and then you guys are gonna share your answers with each other. You're gonna have 60 seconds to do that. So please, if you see somebody here who's sitting alone or by themselves, pull them into your group, introduce yourselves. Hey, if you're someone who's like, oh, I just hate people, why are we doing this? It'll be over in 60 seconds, okay? Okay, so here's the question. So I'll start with, here's the question. What's the one essential item that you need to have with you when you travel? So what's the one thing that you want to have with you, need to have with you when you travel, all right? So find two or three people. Ready, set, go. Take a few more seconds to talk about what you need to talk about. And let's start to wrap it up, Okay, so here's the thing. I'm gonna ask you a question. I'm asking you, so you can just yell this stuff out to you at all of our locations, okay? It's not weird. If you're in your car listening to this, it's not weird, just yell it out, all right? So raise your hand, first of all, raise your hand if you said something about like your item was related to food or snacks or something like that. It was an edible item. What was the, yell out some of your stuff. What's your essential food?
Water?
I mean, water is essential. Water is essential. Anything else? What else? Oh, gummy bears. Yeah, see, okay, you're my kind of people, because actually, so here's the thing. Those of you who know me, I love taking road trips. I love going on road trips. So for me in the car, one of my essential items, it's gotta be some kind of gummy snack, all right? And the best one, in my opinion, are these. Yeah, I don't know about anywhere else, but in Parkside, people are like, yeah, yes, because we're closer to Jesus. Sour Patch watermelons, these are where it's at. These are where it's at. I know also one of my essential items is the Kit Kat Minis. All right, the Kit Kat Minis, this is good stuff, although I've melted several bags of these. Been very sad. So there are these as well. And then here's my most essential item when I'm driving in the car are sunflower seeds. Sunflower seeds. And this is the actual bag from my car that I pulled out this morning, because this stays with me at all times. I have to say this too. I am not sponsored in any way by any of these companies, right? I'm not making any kickback off of this. I wish that I was, but I'm not. But sunflower seeds, I don't know what it is about this. I don't know the science behind it or whatever, but more than any other energy drink or anything like that, sunflower seeds keep me awake. So if I'm feeling tired and I'm driving, this just does it for me. So sunflower seeds have actually literally saved my life on several occasions. So gotta have these. How many of you guys, like raise your hand if you, at all of our locations, raise your hand if you said something, it was like a comfort item, like something that you just need to be comfortable, something that you need to just like, you know, relax. What, nobody? Anybody? Anybody? What did you have? What's your thing? What's that? Oh, his wallet? Oh yeah, you gotta have your wallet. You gotta have your wallet. Although I will say this, you know what? So here's one thing, whenever I fly, okay, here's my essential item when I fly. I need earbuds, all right? For me, earbuds, if I'm traveling, especially if I'm flying, I need to have earbuds. This is my entertainment, right? So it's how I listen to audiobooks, podcasts, music. And then the real essential part of this is that no matter what's going on the plane, baby crying, drunk guy yelling because he's angry about what, if I put these in, I'm out. I can sleep through anything. I would rather have my earbuds than my wallet. I can like make it by without my wallet somehow, but if I don't have my earbuds, forget about it. So that's like an essential item for me. Maybe if you've ever done any kind of like hiking or any kind of backpacking, or this is now, you know, we're not luxury traveling anymore. Like you're out in the wilderness, like you're on your own. Then I know one essential item that you would want to have is something like this. So this is a compass. And so you're going to have something, right, to kind of guide you, to point you in the right direction so that you know where you're going. And so this is actually what we're going to talk about today, is having something to help you know where north is. Where north is. And so where is north? So we're actually in this series right now called Pack Your Bags. Pack Your Bags. And so just like you would pack for a trip, there are some things that you can do to prepare for what's next in life. And here's what I know for sure. You're going to have transitions. You're going to have some kind of transition in your life. You're probably in the middle of one or two or five right now as we speak. It could be a transition with your job, with school, with where you live, with your relationships, with your health. And the thing about transitions is that they have this way of throwing us for a loop, don't they? Like when you're going through change, when change is right there or you're in the middle of it, it's stressful. And it makes you question yourself, or you're asking, well, what's going to happen next? Or you get anxious, you get frustrated, you feel out of control. This is what transitions do to us. So we want to try to help with that. And last week, our lead pastor, Kent, pointed out that what you do now will lead to freedom in your life later. What you do now is going to lead to freedom in your life later. There are things that we can do to prepare for what's coming. And I want to say this, if you're a student, if you're in high school, if you're in college particularly, this series, today and this whole series really is especially for you. It's for all of us. It's important for all of us. But if you're a student, this is so crucial for you. You're surrounded right now by older people who, if they could, they would grab you by the shoulders and shake you and say, pay attention to this. You got to do this. Okay? And that's me included. So you have, especially, again, if the younger that you are, you have so many transitions ahead of you. You have so many transitions that are coming for you. And these are the types of things that threaten to toss you around, to make you question everything. So I want to give you, especially today, and all of us, a compass of sorts that we can use so that we know no matter what we're going through, no matter what we're facing, no matter what transition, no matter what challenge, you know where north is. Now, in dealing with a compass like this, did you actually know that there's a difference between magnetic north and true north? There's magnetic north and there's true north. So it turns out that magnetic north is what a compass like this points to. And it's actually about 500 miles off of true north. And so I don't want to go too much into it, except it's due to something called magnetic deviation. Today is not a science lesson, because I would totally botch that. But for the most part, I'll actually say this. For the most part, you're okay if you're using a compass. Please don't just throw away all of your compasses, because you're like, this is a piece of junk now. But I love this idea of true north. Of true north. And I think that it can help us today. And so what I want for us today is to determine where true north is. Because if you don't know where true north is, then you risk missing the point. You just risk missing the point. Now, if you're a follower of Jesus, I'm not so much defining true north for you today as I am just reminding you of where true north is. So the writer of Hebrews, this is a letter in the New Testament in Scripture, he captures it well, and he writes this, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Or you can say, let's travel this road, right? Let's go on this journey of life, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. And so he says, what do you want to have if you're doing this race, if you're traveling this road, if you're on this journey of life, what do you fix your eyes on in the horizon? And he's saying, it's Jesus. It's Jesus. Now, when I learned how to drive a car, My dad would always tell me this. He would say, hey, when you're learning to drive, you always want to look right in front of you. That's kind of where you naturally want to look. You want to look right in front of you. But you don't want to do that, because if you look right in front of you, you're going to end up swerving. Like, you're never going to be able to just drive straight if you're looking right in front of you the whole time, especially when you're going like 30, 40, 50 miles an hour. He said, if you want to drive straight, look out. Look at where you want to go. Look way down the road, and you will just go straight. This is the same thing when I teach people how to snowboard. Snowboarding and skiing, one of the hardest parts of that is just getting off the ski lift. Just getting off the ski lift. And those of you who have done this, you know this. You probably wiped out a billion times getting off the ski lift. So what I actually tell people when they're learning to get off of that chair, because it's a moving chair, it's pretty intimidating. You want to look down at your feet. That's where like newbies always will look down at their feet and try to figure out what's going on there. And I'll tell someone, hey, if you're getting off the ski lift, just look out. Look at where you want to go, and your feet will take you there. It's this weird thing. So just as it is in driving, just as it is in snowboarding, so it is in life. It's so easy to get locked in on what's right in front of us. So whatever that is, it's a transition that we're going through. It's some change that we're facing. It's an issue that's not working out in our lives. It's something that we really want. It's a promotion or it's a relationship. And when we get so locked in on this thing right in front of us, you're going to risk kind of being slightly off and then missing the point down the road. So if you truly want to make it to where you want to go in life, no matter what life throws at you, you want to have something that can tell you where true north is. And if you're a follower of Jesus, this means fixing your eyes on Jesus. And so when we remember to do this, when you remember to calibrate your compass to Jesus as true north, and make sure that you don't miss the point. And I want to keep bringing this up because I think as humans, we're really good at missing the point. We're like professionals at missing the point. I could write a book. I can't write a book about very many things. I'm not an expert in very much. I could write a book on missing the point, though. I'm really good at that. And especially when we're going through transitions, that's when it's easiest to lose sight of true north and miss the point. When you're going through change and you're facing change, you're facing uncertainty, it's easier than ever to miss the point. Because I think in transitions, we become obsessed with certain kinds of questions. Think about any challenge that you face, any change you face, any transition you face. Maybe you're going through that now. These are the types of questions that we focus on. We focus on kind of what questions, like what job am I supposed to be working? Right? What door should I pick? Should I pick door A or should I pick door B? Is it option A or is it option B? What door do I go through? What is going to happen here, right? I think that's probably the most, what's going to happen? What's going to happen next? What the heck is going on? Right? So we focus on what questions, or we focus on where questions, like where is the money going to come from? Where am I supposed to be? Right? Am I supposed to be here? Am I supposed to be there? Where am I supposed to go? We focus on when questions, like when is it going to be my turn? You know, when is it finally going to be my turn for X, Y, or Z? Right? When is this going to finally work out? When is this uncertainty going to end? Like, and for the record, these are all understandable questions. They're natural questions. I ask these questions. I've asked these questions. It's not that they're not important. These are important questions. They're just not the most important, okay? So they're important and they're natural, but they're not the most important. When our eyes are fixed on Jesus, when we have our compass kind of set to Jesus as true north, more than, really, these questions here, what, where, and when, these aren't going to be at the top of the list anymore. It's not what, where, or when. It's actually going to be who. And so in your transitions, God is most concerned with who you're becoming. This is so important. And again, this is one of the things that if you're in transition now, if you're headed for transition, knowing this is going to help you so much. That knowing that God is most concerned with who you're becoming. And so in the midst of whatever you're facing, whatever transitions, whatever challenges, and I'll say this, even whatever success you are encountering, if you're not paying attention to who you are becoming, you're missing the point. If you're not paying attention to who you're becoming, you're missing the point. God cares less about where you are and what you do than he does about who you're becoming. Now, you don't just have to take my word for this. Jesus tells a story about this very thing. So in the gospel account of Luke, Jesus tells a parable. Now, parables are these interesting things. Parables are these stories that rabbis would tell, and they're designed to make you feel uncomfortable. If you ever read a parable, this is the purpose of a parable. It's to make you uncomfortable. It's actually to challenge and to confront your preconceived notions about life. And so I'm hoping that this is what we can do today, is be challenged and have some of our preconceived notions and the way that we see life confronted by what Jesus tells us here. So we're gonna pick up in Luke chapter 12, verse 13. There's a huge crowd. There are thousands of people who have gathered to listen to Jesus and to hear him teach. So in verse 13, it says, "Someone in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me.'" And I love how Jesus responds here. He says, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Now, I know that this wasn't his inflection, but it's really fun to imagine Jesus saying it like this. "Man, I'm not your Judge Judy, all right? I'm not Judge Judy here." And I can relate to this, by the way. I'm a middle school teacher. I have kids coming up to me every single day, and they say things to me like this. They're like, "Mr. Heggie, he stole my pencil. He stole my pencil." And the other kid will be like, "Well, he stole my calculator first." And I'm like, and so from now on, I'm actually going to give them my most Christ-like response. And I'm just saying, "Man, I'm not Judge Judy. Figure it out. Figure it out." So I love this. So Jesus is not here to be this guy's Judge Judy, but he does use this opportunity to make a point. And I love this. So he says, and he said to them, "Watch out." He really is just like, "Hey, I'm not here to," he doesn't even solve this guy's problem. He's like, "I'm not your judge." And he moves on. He says, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." Man, if you needed a statement to help remind you of true north, this could be a great one. This could be a great one. You should write it down. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Apparently, people needed to be reminded of this 2,000 years ago. How much more do we need this now, today? Like, is this like such a relevant thing or what? Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. But Jesus is not done. He continues on. And this is where he tells them a parable. And so as we go into this, here's actually my hope for you, that no matter what I say about it, I actually just hope that it challenges you, that it confronts your preconceived notions about life, because that's what the parable was designed to do. So I'm going to walk through it, but hopefully it challenges you in its own way, all right? The ground, and so he's telling the story, and it's a made-up story, but it's designed to challenge us a little bit. "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, 'What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops.'" Now, this is a man who, at the beginning of the story, he's already rich. This is very important, okay? So he's already rich. And then he has a transition. Now, get this. This is actually why I think this is fascinating for us today. It's not a bad transition. It's a good transition. Like, he has a huge harvest, so much so that he didn't even have room for it, right? So he has so much that he doesn't know what to do with it. How many of us would like to have this problem, right? Like, sign me up for that. So here's the thing. Please, 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 please know this, that you still have to be very aware of where true north is, even during a really good transition. Just as much as you would during a challenging transition, you need to know this during a good transition. So you just got a promotion. Who you become during that transition is just as crucial as if you lost your job. And for those of us who, I think it's so easy for us to, like, we all want this problem, right? We all were like, "Oh, please give me more than I want, right? Please give me more than I know what to do with. Please give me more money. I would love to have this problem." But, and we all think that we would handle that so well. I have seen success ruin more people's lives than anything else. I have seen success ruin people's lives more than anything else, more than failure. I've seen success ruin people's lives. I mean, take a look at lottery winners, the history of lottery winners, and enough said, right? Who you become, even during a good transition, it all matters. So you got married, you got a better job, you need to be just as aware of true north and who you're becoming as during a bad transition. It all matters. So this rich guy in this parable, he has to figure out what to do with his good fortune. And then he said, this is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And then I will say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. So this man's plan for his surplus is to tear everything down and then upgrade. So he wanted to tear everything down and then upgrade, build bigger barns. Now, again, please keep in mind, this guy was already rich at the beginning of the story. The guy was already rich. So his barns were probably already pretty big, at least big enough. And he says, man, this is great. I now have even more than I had before. So I'm going to build myself a bigger storage unit. And then I just get to kick back. And the story doesn't end here. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? Isn't this an intense story? Now, I don't want you to get too zoomed in on the fact that this guy dies. Remember, it's a fictional story, all right? This is designed to challenge you a little bit. It's designed to confront some things about you. I mean, and I would say this, as Americans, this parable, it should be pretty challenging for us. Should be pretty challenging for us. And what this story represents is a profound lesson in missing the point. A profound lesson in missing the point. This guy who's already rich, who already has more than enough, was given even more. And what he decided to do with it, which was keep it to himself, what he decided to do with it reflected who he was becoming. What he decided to do with that was reflecting who he was becoming. So instead of becoming more generous, instead of realizing, man, God has given me so much, how can I give this back? Instead of becoming more generous, he was actually becoming more greedy and more self-centered. And so Jesus tells this story as a warning. It matters who you're becoming. Do not miss the point. And so this is kind of where I want us to just stew in that today a little bit, is, man, who are you becoming? And what is true north, really? And so I want to ask you a question. What is your north right now? Or another way to ask it is, what has been your north? Or another way to ask this is, how have you defined success up to this point, up to today? Now, I know that you know what true north is supposed to be because I told you at the beginning here. But that's different, right? I know a lot of you are going to say, it's Jesus. And I'm going to be like, okay, but really, what has been north? Like, come on. What has been north for you, for real? Now, here's one of the ways you can think about this. If you take an inventory of your life right now, and for the record, we won't be able to do all of this today together, but if you take an inventory of your life right now, your words, and this is your words when people are when you're putting on your best show for people, and this is your words when you're by yourself or in your car driving home during traffic on 76, okay? Your words, take an inventory of your words, your actions, your time and how you spend it, your energy and how you spend it, your money and how you spend it, what you think about and what you worry about. If you take an inventory of all that, what would that reveal? If you took an inventory of that, where do you think north actually is for you? I think this is probably true for a lot of us. Is it money? Is it making more money? Now, I want to point this out. Andy Stanley, in his book, How to Be Rich, it's a great book, references a study that, this poll that asked people to define what rich was. Like, to define, like, hey, what's rich? Like, to you, what's rich? What does it mean to be rich? And do you know what everybody's answer was? It doesn't matter how much money they already made, whether it was a modest amount or whether they made $1 million. You know what everybody's answer was? Double. Everybody's answer was double. So if somebody made $50,000 a year, what was rich to them was double what they were making. If somebody was already making $1 million, you know what rich was to them? Double what they were making. And here's why money cannot be north for you, because money will never be enough. You know what I mean? The amount of money you make will never, ever, ever be enough. That is a moving target. You will never reach that. Okay, so if that's north, you'll never get to where you're going. You will never, ever, ever get there. So if money is your north, I don't think that's gonna cut it. Maybe north has been your job or something with your career, and I have seen so many people who have worked so hard to get to a certain point in their career, or they've worked so hard to get a certain amount of money or to a certain status, and when they got to that particular destination, whether it was the job, the promotion, the salary level, the relationship status, right, they got there and were like, I don't know who I am anymore. I've talked to so many people in that situation. Like I said, I have seen success, quote unquote success, ruin more people's lives than anything else. And so I think today we are truly in need of redefining what success is, redefining what north is for us. And if we want to actually be happy, if we want to actually have joy, actually have peace, then we're going to have to reframe everything. We're going to have to see everything through a new lens. Or we're going to have to recalibrate this compass to true north. But for you, you know, I think a big question is like, what has north been? What has north been? How have you defined success? Where have you been placing your trust? And where have you been finding your peace? And I'll share a story that I've had to be confronted with just recently. So in the last month or two, I've even shared this before a little bit, that my wife and I, we've been looking for a house. And ever since I first shared that, we've had just ups and downs. It's been a wild roller coaster. It's been crazy. You know, so we put an offer on a house that didn't work out. We put an offer on another house. We got through the process, got to the inspection, and then that just all fell apart. And so we had to walk away from that place. And then it's just been like really tough. And then the whole time, right, all of this money is involved, and you know, you're thinking about all this stuff. And then I remember I was driving home from work. This was a few weeks ago. It was a Wednesday. Or no, it was a Tuesday, sorry. I was driving home from work, and I was listening to this audio book. And as I often do, I just kind of drifted off. I was just like dreaming about something. I'm not paying attention to anything in the audiobook. I'm in my own world, okay? It's just running. And all of a sudden, something in the audiobook, this line popped out, and it snapped me out of my like dream state. And here was the line. And I don't know anything about what they were talking about before this, but this is the line. They said, and they did this so that they would find their peace in God, not money. That was a line. They did this so that their peace would be in God, not money. And for whatever reason, it popped me out of my dream state. And I was like, oh, I'm like, I think that was for me. Whatever that line was, I think that was for me. And then I was like, okay. And then I didn't think about it. And I got home later that night. And then Carly and I, we got some like weird, bad news, like financial news that night. Something that just really made me mad. And without going too much into it, it was tax related. So enough said, okay? Enough said. Anyway, I was so, we hear this stuff, and I was so mad. I don't even know who I was mad at. You know what I mean? You're just so mad. You're not even mad at a person. You're just like, I'm angry, you know? And we ended up having our the biggest argument of our marriage that night. Haven't had one before that. That was like that. Haven't had one after that. And I remember I was lying in bed that night, and I was still fuming. And you know how like you just, when you're mad, you're just like running through these conversations in your head with nobody, just imaginary people. You're just like, this. And I'm still steaming, right? And I can't even sleep. And that's a problem for me. I sleep really easily, so I can't even sleep. And all of a sudden, that line just came right back to me in the middle of my anger while I was lying there in bed, and it was like, their peace was in God and not in money. And then it was like, just dagger into my chest. And I just had this moment. I was like, oh my gosh, look at me right now. Look at this person that I've become. I'm just riding the wave. I got a little bit of bad news, and here I am just freaking out. You know, man, my trust and my peace right now is in money. Not in God, not in God. So it's this painful reminder for me that, hey, true north for me is not my money. It cannot be my money. So other people might trust their money, right? But I'm called to trust in God. And I had a couple of friends, really good friends, remind me about this last weekend. They shared this verse with me. It's from Deuteronomy. Some trust in horses and some trust in chariots, but I trust in the Lord, the name of the Lord our God. Like, just this reminder of, like, you know, some people, they trust in money, they trust in their jobs, they trust in their careers, they trust in things. But if we're following Jesus, we're called, man, to put our trust in God. And here's the funny thing. As upset as I was that night, right, 24 hours later, everything was fine. You know what I mean? It wasn't even a big deal, right? So it's just funny how that works. But in that moment, I was like, the world is ending. Man, I do not want to be someone who goes as my money goes. I do not want to be someone who goes as my money goes. I want to become more like Jesus. So for us, a dollar amount can't be true north for us. A job can't be true north for us. The what can't be true north for us. Because that what is going to change, right? Your money is going to go up and it's going to go down. It's going to go in, it's going to go out. It's going to come and it's going to go. Your job, same thing. Your relationship status, same thing. But the who, in terms of who you are becoming, that's what matters. And that's who you're going to have to live with. Who you're becoming matters more than what you do. And trusting Jesus, fixing our eyes on Jesus, setting Jesus as true north helps us become who we're meant to be. Think about it this way. Do you know you have someone in your life who just brings out the best in you? That person who just brings out the best in you, when you spend time with them, for whatever reason, they draw out your best qualities. Like they. So if you're not in Parkside, the lights went out and we just had a light show. That was amazing. That was incredible. Maybe if you were falling asleep before, you're awake now. Maybe that was God being like, you need to hear this, okay? But you know, you have that person, like maybe it's because they challenge you, they encourage you, they push you. Some people, it's like just by spending time with them, it's almost like they rub off on you, like through osmosis or something. And so some of you have friends like that, or you have family like that, or you're married to someone like that. And this is what Jesus does for us. That he brings out the best in us. If you're ever afraid by following Jesus, by having faith, by being in this thing, that you are going to lose yourself, can I just assure you that you will actually find yourself? You will actually find the best version of yourself. The same way that you have people in your life who bring out the best in you, Jesus brings out the best in us. So what does it look like when we set Jesus as true north? Take a look at what the Apostle Paul writes in a letter to the Colossians. And this is Colossians 3, verse 12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. And for the record, if you needed to start somewhere, how about starting with who you are? I love this line. You are dearly loved. Man, you are dearly loved. In terms of who you're going to become, there's good things in store there, but who you are now, you are dearly loved. Stop trying so hard to find love in a million other places. You are already dearly loved. And because of that, we can now be free to become the best versions of ourselves. And that looks like clothing ourselves with compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. And then he goes on in verse 13, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Who are we becoming? Hopefully people who forgive, who let things go, who have grace and mercy and compassion on people. And lastly, and most importantly, over all of these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. More than anything, over everything, most importantly, put on love. Folks, when you fix your eyes on Jesus, and when Jesus is your true north, here's what you discover, that your deepest calling, more than anything that you do, is to become more loving. That your deepest calling, more than anything that you do, no matter where you end up geographically, no matter how much money you make or don't make, we should become more loving, because that is what it means to become more like Jesus. Now, to completely for us, this is hard work. I'm going to not lie to you. To redefine true north for you, right? To fix the way, to fix your lens, the lens that you see the world through, that this is, there's a lot of heavy lifting involved with this. We're not going to be able to finish this work today in our time together. So I want to give you something to help you and your family and your friends do some of this work. And our lead pastor Kent talked about this last week. Do the thing. Do the thing, do the thing, do the work. So what we've done is we've put together some questions for you to work through, and we've put them all together in one place online. So here's the link. This is epic.church/true north. So take the time, write this down. If you're gonna take a picture of it, take a picture of it. We have all of these questions here. There's about 10, 11, 12 questions somewhere around there. And they have questions like this. I'll give you some examples here. What do you think has been north for you recently, right? This question that I asked you a little bit earlier. How have you defined success? And here's what we want you to do. And also on that document or on that site, we have a bunch of reminders for you as well about what true north is, verses that you can use to help you set your perspective and to set true north for you, bunch of questions for you to work through. And as you leave today, I want you to work your way through those questions. If you're in a life group, work with them, work through them in your life group, call up a friend, meet up at a coffee shop. If you're married, set aside some time, work through these questions together. You could just do it by yourself. Set aside some quiet time, do that. Not all of the questions will be helpful for everybody, that's okay. Hopefully you can find two or three that help you do this work of thinking about, where have I been? How have I typically defined success? And how can I now recalibrate myself to fix my eyes on Jesus and set him as true north? And again, if you're here and you're a student, figuring this out now is gonna save you so many detours in your future. Do this work. There are gonna be so many things that are clamoring for your attention, so many things that you're gonna be tempted to give your life to be distracted by, to put your trust in. And because of that, it's gonna be so easy to miss the point. It's gonna be so easy to miss the point. So do this work, do this work. And I wanna share one last thing with you. This is from Hebrews chapter 6. The writer says, we have this hope, and what he's talking about is this hope that we have in Jesus, that when we fix our eyes on Jesus, when we put our trust in Jesus, when we set him as true north, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. And so here's why you should put your trust and your hope in Jesus. Here's why you should set him as true north. Because when you do that, not only do you become more concerned with who you're becoming, not only will you find the best version of yourself, but you will actually begin to worry less and less and less about the what and the when and the how, because Jesus grounds us. He is firm and he is secure. And here's the thing, nothing else can really do that. Nothing else can really do that. Now, don't get me wrong, you can use money as your anchor, all right? You can hold on to money all you want as your anchor. You can hold on to your career as your anchor. A lot of us have done this and are currently doing this, all right? So we can hold on to your career. You can hold on to your relationship status. You can even hold on to your health as your anchor. But here's a question. I really want you to think about this. You can hold on to anything as an anchor, but can your anchor hold you? I can't even take credit for that question. I got this from another pastor, but it's a good question, isn't it? Isn't it? It's a good question. Can your anchor hold you? So no matter what happens to you, right? What's going to keep you steady? What's going to hold you? What's going to keep you secure? What's going to sustain you if you lose your job? What's going to sustain you if you lose your health? What's going to sustain you if you lose someone you care about? What has the capacity, what has the ability to hold you no matter what you go through in life? The ups and the downs, the good and the bad, what has the capacity to hold you? Not money. It's not your job. It's only Jesus. It's only Jesus. So when it comes to who and what I give my life to, who I put my trust in, who I'm gonna put my hope in, I gotta go with Jesus. I gotta go with Jesus, and I hope that you do too. That you put your hope in the anchor who can hold you through anything. That you put your trust in the true north who will lead you into the best version of you, into who God has made you to be. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you are our anchor. We thank you that you are true north. I pray, God, that you would help us to do this work, to trust you, to put our hope in you, to find our peace in you. And as we do that, we're believing that you're going to lead us into the best version of ourselves. So God, today, be our hope, be our trust, be our peace, be our anchor. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So here's what we're going to do. One last thing today. We're going to sing a song together. And as we sing this song together, I want this to be your prayer. God, no matter what I have put my trust in up to this point, I want to put my trust and my hope and my security and my peace in you. I want you to be my anchor who holds me through everything. Let's sing this together.
When the storm is raging, when the tempest comes, I will hold to you. When the day is failing, in the dead of night, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. When the storm is raging, oh my God is strong. His love has overcome, never changing, unshaken. I will not be moved, my anchor holds. Now in my weakness, you are proven strong. All my hope, all my strength in you. My rock and refuge, my solid ground. All I have, all I need is you. We sing, my anchor holds. When the storm is raging, my God is strong. His love has overcome, never shaken, unchanging. I will not be moved, my anchor holds. I will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. We will not be shaken. I will trust in you.